Mary. They said the climate changing, the poor people in the cold, but you keep preaching to their soul. But we don't leave till everybody's free, and we won't sleep till everybody eats. Until lives matter, more than ties matter.
Say, the government keep lying to me, telling me that they're gonna set the people free, but the power falls when you catch us on the knees. Heaven, please, we're in a state of emergency. See, we need a
strong God.
Real strong, yeah. We need a
real God.
Yeah, yeah. The God with the
resurrection power from the grave
to take away the hate, to heal the human race. See, we need a strong God. See, we need a
let's go.
My country, tears of thee, sweet land of liberty. When will we finally see? We need a strong God, yeah. The government keep lying to me, telling me that they gonna set the people free, but the power falls when you catch us on our knees.
Oh, not
heaven, please, we're in a state of emergency, cause we need a strong God, yeah. We need the real God, the God with the resurrection power from the grave,
yes.
To take away the hate,
yes.
To heal the human race.
Come on.
So we need a
I found my way without you. scripture. Thank you, Kirsty. Let's just keep a moment of quiet as we then maybe join with the people of Plymouth this day, to remembering them in our hearts and in our prayers, and also, of course, the people of Afghanistan as we remember them today. So as we join together with those online, those here physically in church as one church, we pray this old prayer that we've been sharing throughout this time together. We pray together. Thanks be to you, my Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. Well, of course, in one sense, there can only really be one hymn to sing about bread, which is Guide Me, O Thy Great Redeemer. So would you like to stand? And if you would like to sing to your heart, Content Music Group, would you like to come and join us, and we'll sing together this wonderful and well-known hymn. I have to say, we had a number of Welsh guards in here yesterday, and they sang really loud, so I'm sure you'll be able to do likewise. If you'd like to sing, please stand and join. Thank you.
Thank you.
was interesting, everyone. Interesting. I'm sure those at home had a jolly good felt deeply moved. Did you feel deeply moved, Bob? Did you feel deeply moved?
Me.
Poor old Luke's going, what was that? It's a passionate hymn. My friends, let us light our candles to remind us of God's presence and God's love amongst us. And of course, people at home, they're so good. So many people have been faithful. I would imagine candle sales have gone up during this pandemic, you know? There's so many people I know like them for all sorts of reasons. It just reminds us that we're in the presence of God. Whether we get all the right verses and all the right notes in anywhere near the right order. That was different. My friends, let us listen to our Bible reading today, which Dave is kind of going to read for us today.
The reading today is from John chapter 6, verses 1 to 14. And 24 to 35, and it's headed up, the bread of life. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is, the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing those who were ill. Then Jesus went up the mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming towards him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this man to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "Take more than half a year's wages to buy bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with five small barley loaves and two small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" And Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over, let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. After the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world." Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again from the mountain by himself. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you had the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires. And Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they asked him, what sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestor left the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread of heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. So they said, always give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Kirsty, hand over to you. Just take a moment. Yeah, you're right. Okay.
Hello again. So, we've been looking at the Lord's Prayer as a way to engage with prayer in our daily lives. And today brings us to the line, give us today our daily bread. A simple petition asking for the most basic of human nourishment, but encompassing all the physical, human, and spiritual gifts we need to live. In many ways, it should be the simplest of all the lines in the Lord's Prayer, but there's so much to it, which we're going to be exploring in two parts this morning. In the first part, we will be focusing on bread in the sense of physical sustenance. Thank you, Georgie, for that fitting. And the next bit, God plus bread. And the next bit, physical sustenance. And in the second part, we'll be looking at praying the line, give us today our daily bread, in the sense of spiritual sustenance. The nourishment of both body and soul that God provides us with every day. So, bread. We see it every day. Of course, now we're more used to seeing it, like in the next slide, pre-packaged. But there's something about the smell of fresh bread, and it's much more tangible if we imagine it like this on the next slide. I like bread like that. So Jesus teaches us to pray that God would give us our daily bread in Matthew chapter 6 verse 11 and Luke chapter 11 verse 3. And this very practical thought lies right at the heart of the Lord's Prayer. So why bread? If we're praying for physical sustenance or to fulfill just our basic needs, why not just say that? Why not just say, Lord, please give us what we need today? But obviously Jesus wasn't telling his disciples to pray only for bread, but bread
was a staple in the diet of Jews at the time and had been for many years. As we heard in the story of the feeding of the 5,000, thank you David for reading it so lovely.
A boy had brought loaves and fish to eat, and this would have been a typical meal at the time, which would have looked more like the next picture, loaves and fishes. And so bread was representative of all food and nourishment. However, symbolically for Jews at the time, bread also served as a powerful reminder of God's provision for his people, taken from the book of Exodus. We remember how God cared for the Israelites when they were in the wilderness after escaping slavery in Egypt. When they wandered in the desert, life was hard, and soon the people began to complain that it would have been better to go back to Egypt, where it was easier because they had food to eat. And in response to these complaints, next slide please, George, God promised to rain down bread from heaven in Exodus chapter 16, verse 4. The people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white like coriander seed and tasted like wafers made with honey. And that's from Exodus 16, verse 31. So when God miraculously fed his people from heaven, he did so by giving them bread. The Jews still acknowledge God as the provider, and all Jewish prayers at meals that include bread start off with this blessing. Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe, who has brought forth bread from the earth. So bread itself is very important. But if we look back again at the two examples we've just seen, the feeding of the 5,000 and the manna from heaven, the bread doesn't just come by itself. It's usually accompanied by something else. In the feeding of the 5,000, it was both bread and fish. And the manna from heaven came with quail. So even when bread is literal, we can also recognize that it's representative, standing in not just for bread, but for all of our basic needs. In modern terms, it could be equated to money, not wealth and riches type money, just money enough to buy food, shelter, clothing. In fact, colloquially, bread has been used as a synonym for money. There was even a sitcom in the 80s called Bread. I don't remember it, I'm too young. But I know that my parents watched it. I believe it dealt with the subject of money or lack thereof. And not so long ago, one partner would go out to work, earn wages, and bring the money into the home, and that person would be referred to as the breadwinner. It used to be exclusively the husband, but it's not anymore. But bread remains a symbol of the rudimentary basis of provisions for our needs. Next slide, please, George. That's all right. Have you ever seen this before? Maslow's hierarchy of needs, proposed by Abraham Maslow in his 1943 paper, A Theory of Human Motivation, in the journal Psychological Review. It's used in psychology to identify the basic physiological needs of humans, such as food, water, and shelter. So those are foundational, with our needs for security, relationship, and self-esteem building on that foundation. The idea is that we need to work our way up through the hierarchy, with each layer being made possible by those beneath it, but each layer being necessary for us to flourish. Personally, I think it looks like one of those dodgy pyramid schemes. So I prefer the next picture because there's a cute doggy in it. So this is exactly the same, it just looks a bit nicer. The needs on the lower tier are obviously essential for life. Food, water, air, shelter. While the top tier are things that are important for Maslow's word is self-actualization. I think as Christians, we would use the term wholeness. So for us, that would be things like fellowship, discipleship, and most importantly, prayer. And as Christians, we know that God wants us to be truly whole, to be ourselves. And so all of these things are important. And so it shouldn't be a pyramid. It should be a circle. Jesus instructs us then, in this fourth petition of the Lord's Prayer, to come to God in a spirit of humble dependence, asking him to provide what we need to sustain us from day to day, no matter how mundane it might seem. That doesn't mean we're given a license to ask for anything. It's about moderate use of food and material things. But we are encouraged to make our needs known to him, trusting that he will provide, just as he did for the Israelites in the desert. We should not be greedy in our requests. In the original Greek, it can be translated as, give to us daily the bread that is apportioned to us this day. That is, the bread that we need to survive, but no more. God has already taught us not to ask for more than we need in the Old Testament. Next slide, please, George. Oh, is it not that? Oh, it's gone after the song. I'm sorry, that's my fault. Give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. That's from Proverbs chapter 30, verse 8. So God provided manna from heaven daily, not enough to be stored away for later, enough for the provision of that day, and would provide more on the following day. In one commentary on Matthew's gospel I read, it puts this idea succinctly. The fourth petition is the politico-economic petition. We are not told to pray for daily cake. We may be grateful, of course, when cake is given, but we may only legitimately pray for bread, that is, for necessities. Basically, Jesus instructs us to pray for what we need on a day-to-day basis to sustain life, but no more. So God is caring about our physical needs, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be caring about ourselves too. By praying for our daily physical nourishment, we are also asking God for our own strength to fulfill our daily tasks, to work, to eat, to run our households, to care for our families and pets, to get enough exercise, and this one's very, very important, particularly for those of us stood up here, to get enough rest. Not only do we need to pray for our daily bread, but we also need to remember to accept it. It's important to note, it doesn't read, give me my daily bread. We are taught to pray for our daily bread. Not me and my, but us and our. God is taking care of our personal needs, but also reminding us that we are all part of God's family, brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray for the needs of others and are not selfish. God feeds us together. While most of us listening this morning or catching up later online won't know what it's like to go a day without food, we must remember that even today, with all the technology and advancements in science and medicine, there are still so many that don't have the luxury of knowing where their next meal is coming from. As we pray together, we think not only of ourselves and those we know that have the basic essentials, but also that we pray for all of God's children so that we know that one day there will be a day without hunger. But there are many types of hunger, of course. We have been talking so far about physical hunger, for food, for material goods to keep us safe. But we also have a spiritual hunger, a need to feel connected to something. As Christians, we know that we are all connected as God's children, and that we hunger for that relationship with Him to grow deeper through our prayer lives. And so as we go on to the next song, Lord, I Need You explores that hunger for needing God, not just every day, but every hour, to be in relationship with Him at all times. And we will then explore the spiritual sustenance of our daily bread in part two. Thank you.
I need you, my love, to share. where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Thank you. So, spiritual bread. We need God every hour of every day, and we need Christ within us. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3 states, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord," which Jesus quotes in response to his first temptation. Jesus understood that there was more to life than just physical hunger. And just as Jesus did not live by bread alone, but spent considerable time in prayer and meditation, we too need spiritual nourishment. The sharing of food, both actually and symbolically, was a central feature of Jesus' life, just as it plays an important role in our lives. Next one, please. When we hear that man, next one, or woman, cannot live by bread alone, this is true on the physical level, as we've already explored. We need water, oxygen, shelter, etc. But the second part of this quote, next one please, "but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord," explains the spiritual hunger that we experience, as well as the physical hunger. We need physical sustenance of food, but we also need the spiritual sustenance that comes from Scripture and the Word of God. So when we pray, "Give us today our daily bread," what else might we be praying for? Next one, please. The reading from earlier in John chapter 6 is the famous story of the feeding of the 5,000, one of the great miracles performed by Jesus, and one of the signs that point to him as the Messiah. Its placement at this point acts as a signpost to the real crux of the chapter. After the big miracle, Jesus almost reenacting the feeding of the Israelites in the wilderness, he makes a statement. Jesus describes himself as the bread of life, one of the seven I am sayings in the Gospel of John. If we take the idea that the bread in the Lord's Prayer is also a metaphor for Jesus himself, the bread of life, then by praying for our daily bread, we are praying for a daily dose of Jesus, for Jesus to be with us each day, for us to feed on him and to be strengthened by his Spirit. Jesus expands on this in verses 48 to 51. Next one, please, George. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Here, Jesus ties together the physical bread of heaven that was sent by God to feed the Israelites with the spiritual bread of heaven that God has sent in himself. Jesus is saying that both the Israelites in the wilderness and those listening to him now were focusing on the wrong thing. It was the soul that was hungry more than the body, and only he could offer spiritual nourishment. While this statement made many following him at the time uneasy, the idea of actually eating his flesh was a bit weird, but of course he wasn't being literal in that sense. From a Jewish perspective, the bread can be taken to the bread of the heavenly kingdom, can be taken to mean the bread of the heavenly kingdom. Luke tells how one guest said to Jesus when he was dining at the house of a Pharisee, "Blessed is he who shall eat the bread in the kingdom of God." That's from Luke chapter 14, verse 15. The Jews held a vivid idea that when the Messiah came, this would herald a golden age, and there would be what they called the messianic banquet, at which the chosen ones of God would sit down and have an amazing feast. And this is explored in several of Jesus's parables. But from the Christian perspective, we already see Jesus as the Messiah and understand that he was speaking prophetically about his sacrifice and the Last Supper, the latter of which forms the basis for our communion. Next one, please, George. It's not surprising then that the bread in the Lord's Prayer has been identified with the bread of the Lord's Supper. From the very beginning, the Lord's Prayer has been closely connected with the communion. In the very first orders of service, it's always laid down that the Lord's Prayer should be prayed at the Lord's table, a prayer granting us the privilege to receive our daily bread, the spiritual food that we are to receive. When we went to Brunel a couple of years ago, it was only in 2018, but it feels like forever ago, I was leading a small group looking at ordinary inanimate objects and how God might be speaking to us through them. And one of these objects was a portable power pack, like the ones to charge a mobile phone when you're on the go. Here's a few examples of them. The pink one, the one there on the day was pink because it was mine. So someone said that it was like when you're praying out and about. The difference between using a portable power pack is that it keeps your phone going when you're out until you can get home to have a full charge. And that's a little bit like God. If you're out and about saying your prayers, talking to God, that keeps you going until you can take communion, which is like the big recharge we need to get through the week. Just as God provided manna in the wilderness daily, so too are we taught to pray only for the coming day's provision. So this teaches us not to worry about a distant and unknown future, almost to live one day at a time. So when Jesus teaches the Lord's Prayer, the Exodus story would have been an example on everyone's mind. The children of Israel were starving in the wilderness. Next one, please, George. And God sent them the manna, the food from heaven. But there was one condition. They must gather only enough for their immediate needs. If they tried to gather too much and to store it up, it went bad. They had to be satisfied with enough for the day. We learn, therefore, not to give way to anxiety, but to trust in God that he will provide us with what we need each day as it comes. It also reminds us to have trust in God for all of our provisions, both earthly and spiritually. All our food comes from creatures and plants created by God, and therefore is a direct gift from him. The workers who tend the land or care for animals receive their skills from God, and so on. This is also a very Jewish reading of the Lord's Prayer. We've looked at the Lord's Prayer in Hebrew, and as we listened to the prayer earlier, that the Jews pray before eating a meal with bread in it, looking at the food of the earth. God is working all around us. By understanding the spiritual dimension of daily bread, this doesn't take away the need for the physical. The two aren't mutually exclusive. In many ways, we can see prayer itself as our modern day manna. Each day we open ourselves up to God and are given our provision for that day. He gives us what we need, no more, no less. The same can be true of our personal discipleship and our Bible study. It's the spiritual food of God's word that we need, just as much as physical food. God cares for us as a whole person. A car won't run if there's no fuel in the tank, just as a person can't function on an empty stomach. But the car also won't start if the battery is flat. It will overheat if there's no water, and so on. The same is true for a human. Even if we have fuel in the tank, there are still so many things we need, both physical and metaphysical, to make us whole. God can provide all things. All we need to do is ask, and then be sure to follow his advice. In summary, the fourth petition, "Give us today our daily bread," is indeed a prayer for daily provision, for food and sustenance on a physical level, but it's also a prayer for spiritual nourishment, for the eschatological provision of life that comes through believing in Jesus, the bread of life. Amen.
Thank you, Kirsty. I must admit, I'm really enjoying looking at the Lord's Prayer because so often we just say it, don't we? Do you find that? Every day? And it becomes so familiar to us. But taking this time over these weeks really gives us a chance to explore what each of the phrases and the
said in our own strength alone. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And forgive us, Lord, when we fail to see the interconnectedness of all things, all people, and all creation. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
For my Almighty God, who does indeed forgive all who truly repent, have mercy then upon us this morning. Pardon and deliver us from all our sin. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us together in his eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Someone's very kind of going to lead us in a time of prayer this morning. Someone.
As I read these prayers, when I say Our Father, if you would like to respond with the hear us as we pray. We pray today, Lord, for all conflicts around the world, especially thinking about Afghanistan and the ongoing civil war. We can only look on in horror on the news at what is happening there, but we ask that somehow lives can be better for all of them. Our Father, hear us as we pray. We pray also today for the destruction and lives lost that have been caused by the earthquake in Haiti and the wildfires across Europe recently. We hope that essential aid can be got to those that need it. So much of these have been as a result of climate change, and so help us to understand more and what we can do to slow this down. Our Father, hear us as we pray. Lord, we take a moment to pause and remember today Sophie, her father Lee, Maxine, Stephen and Kate, so brutally and needlessly killed in Plymouth on Thursday. We send our prayers to all those who will have been affected in such a close-knit community, as well as the families of those who've lost loved ones. Our Father, hear us as we pray. Today we give thanks for our young people and the blessing that they are to us all. We thank you for their recent exam results this last week. And whatever the grades that they now can move on with pride and confidence to the next chapter in their lives. Whether that is university, higher education, or some form of employment. Our Father, hear us as we pray. Lord, we give thanks for the wedding between Lizzie and George that took place here in Congresbury yesterday. We wish them all well and send our blessing on them. It's so nice that finally family events such as weddings, christenings and birthdays can be together again, and a chance to not only celebrate but give thanks for families and friends. Our Father, hear us as we pray. We pray for our villages of Banwell and Congresbury and our church communities and all that it has to offer as people together supporting one another and loving each other. Our Father, hear us as we pray. Finally, from the prayer diary today, we celebrate the feast of Mary, Mother of Jesus. I just wanted to take a little bit from this particular prayer that's on the prayer diary. She takes her inspiration as she walked by Jesus from his birth to his death, resurrection, and ascension. What an amazing lady she was. And what an amazing life. Thank you, Lord, for the inspiration that she's given us and still is today. Her faithfulness, her determination, her commitment to love, to trust, to grace, through the tears, through the pain, and into glory. We pray for these qualities in her and in those who share them in today's church. Our Father, hear us as we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Sonia. And Sonia, if I may, thank you so much for praying for Plymouth, but can we also pray for the police officers? Because, as you will know from other people, that it can be a really tough job, and often with very little thanks at times like this. So we pray for all those involved. As we are focusing today in our journey of the Lord's Prayer on Jesus and on the bread of life, I thought we would take this opportunity to share the communion prayer in a slightly different way. We've done this a number of times over the years, and that's to use a song, which is by Stuart Townend and Keith and Kristen Getty. It's called Behold the Lamb. And as we share the song, I will actually break the bread and pour the wine in response to the words of the song. Does that make sense? We've done it before, haven't we? Some people really love it. If it's not your thing, don't worry. It'll be back to normal next week. But it's good to do things that are slightly different sometimes. So, if you'd like to stand, and the music group, are you going to sing this, or do you want to come and sing it? You know it quite well? Or not? Okay. We'll sing it with the... you got the backing track?
The backing track's on here. Do you want me to change it quickly?
We'll sing... Those of you who know it well, just sing it. That will be lovely. It's fairly well known.
Thank you.
well done, everyone. Without having a lead singer in it as well. Thank you, Kirsty, for also helping. Do you want to take a seat and we'll share the Lord's Prayer? We got there, especially at the last verse, so that was good. And let's just, as we have been sharing over these weeks, let's just pause for a moment and then remind ourselves, before we just launch into the Lord's Prayer, that God's very presence is here amongst us. He listens for each of your voices and delights in hearing who you are and what you bring. So trusting in this promise and this prayer that has been handed down across the ages and throughout the world, we pray to our Heavenly Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, we break this bread to share in the body of Christ. For though we are one in him, we are one in the body, because we all share. Come to share communion today. We've found over the weeks since we've been able to put a small spot of wine on the bread that most people prefer that. So what I'm going to do is I'll continue to put a little dab of wine on your bread wafer, but if you don't want that, just let me know. So rather than asking for it, now you'll get it unless you ask for different. Is that alright? I love the Anglican Church. We're going to share a lovely song by Audrey Azzard as we share communion together, and then we'll sing a song with the music group. Music group, would you like to come up first? Is that alright?
To preach to all thy grace.
So to hymns and songs for today, we'll put up all the songs that we've sung today, and also thank you for those who sent in songs. You can see a real selection of them there. You've got everything from a new hymn by... I'd like to come up and enjoy yourself. That would be lovely.
Oh, no. I've got back to green now.
No.
So we'll
listen carefully. Can we stand, everyone, and see what we can do by the Lord of Sea and Sky? praying for each other, for those at home, as Kirsty shared, that we pray not just for ourselves, but actually for all people everywhere. We say together, may the Lord bless us and keep us, may his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. May he always look kindly upon us and give us his peace. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon each and every one of us, inspire and enable us to share the love of Jesus wherever we are this week, and may he be with us always. Amen. Thank you, everyone. If you'd like to take your seats. I'm looking to my friends at the back. Have we got any bands that we need to read this week? We've done all that. Right, wonderful. So those who are at home, if they're hearing us, can we... They can't see us, but they can hear us. So, rather than waving at them, can you say goodbye, everyone?